Thank you for the invitation. And this is what I'm going to talk about, Scandinavian Links. This map was drafted and presented later. It was drafted in the beginning of the 1980s, presented in the end of the 1980s by the European Round Table of Industrialists. And they discussed what they called missing links in Europe. And missing links are infrastructural links, and they are defined as places where you have a separation of systems, where you have a barrier between systems. Systems on the sides of such missing links do not cooperate or interact very good. And here I have tried to draft distance as time around the island of Zealand, and then it looks a little more isolated than it usually looks on maps. And here we have the tree out of 14 European missing links within a distance of 150 kilometers from this room. And that is a very large concentration of system breaks when you look at this map. And they are now called different things. The same concept has been carried up through European Union as TEN projects and structure and whatever, but they are in principle, the same concept as is used today in the European Union. This is the first one, the Great Belt Link, the one that connects the island of Zealand with continental Denmark via the island of Funen, which is also connected by bridges to continental Jutland. Well, this is the largest suspension bridge in the world. I know that there are some people in Japan who says they have a larger one, but in Denmark, this is the largest suspension bridge in the world. This is a supertanker. This is a supertanker. This is the highest point in Denmark. And what happened with this fantastic bridge? It's twice the size of the Golden Gate Bridge. What happened with that bridge, which is also having a train connection via a tunnel under the belt, but what happened was that Denmark changed very rapid. Transport substituted communication. Material interaction substituted immaterial interaction. Domestic air traffic reduced instantly. Railroad traffic boosted by this bridge and tunnel. The logistic of Denmark changed from having two logistic centers, everybody, now they used only one logistic center. People could go over and visit their old mother in Jutland by leaving home in the morning and coming home in the afternoon. They didn't have to put in an overnight. The old ferries were very inconvenient for the time when everybody wanted to use them because they were really bottlenecks Friday evening and Sunday evening. We could wait maybe 8 hours. And when the bridges and tunnels were ready, 1997 to 98, what happened was that the same day, the whole big construction manpower disappeared, and the very big manpower, the labor force that were working on the ferries and the distribution centers connected to the ferries disappeared overnight. Minus 5,000 jobs in two ferry towns. And this is one of them. You can see how it has reacted. No more railroad line here, no more ferries. There were 10 ferries every day crossing, but they disappeared. And the ferry towns had, of course, foreseen this, and they have been crying in Parliament, and they have been crying to everybody who had a chance to substitute this activity for them. And they got a substitution. Korsør, one of them, this is, by the way, Nyborg, the other one, but Korsør on Zealand, was provided with the naval station of Copenhagen. 6,000 jobs, more or less, came out there. That was the first of this three missing links, which is now a link. And I'm going to talk a little more about the two other ones. But just first to show you how the reaction to this link was. This is traffic, and it's cars, and here we open it, and wow, up, and then a new growth regime. And the reason for this very instant growth, the jump it's called, was that all networks were there already, families, organizations, companies, the Danish state, everybody were interacted, and you just have to accept there's a new situation and then use the new situation. That was done almost again overnight. And then to something different, namely the Øresund area. This is pre-Brits, we are here. And again, distance between Zealand and Scania in Sweden is measured by time before the bridge. There was some interaction here. We had something like 18 million people crossing per year. Very rapid and very efficient ferries, especially up here between Elsinore and Helsingborg, but also rapid ferries down here between Copenhagen and the center of Malmö. But the interaction was mostly on retail goods shopping, driven by price differences. Labor market was not very much interactive. Only 2,000 out of the daily commuters on this map crossed Öresund every day. And we have a commuting flow here on the map on more than 1 million people every day. So 2,000 people crossing by ferries, nothing. And most of them were up here in the northern part of the Öresund. We discussed at that time growth factors by connecting these two population and business centers, Copenhagen and Malmö Lund. Copenhagen with 1.8 million inhabitants and Malmö Lund with 500,000. And we thought that if you had this bridge, you would concentrate a lot of Scandinavian traffic, long distance traffic, and that would mean that the cross point in Copenhagen, Malmö, Lund would be enforced. And a cross point is a place where you locate yourself, not just to sell hot dogs and gasoline, but also to have business, not having anything to do with logistics. A cross point is a very attractive position to locate in. The other discussion was around centrality. Metropolitan products, culture, high-class retail, transport. We had, before the Brits to Sweden, we had a competition with Stockholm, but the hinterland boundary was clearly in Öresund. Distance played no role for distribution or demand for the metropolitan products. I have 600 kilometers between Copenhagen and Stockholm, and the hinterland boundary between these two metropolitan units was located in the Öresund. And then also, this thing would be helpful in the position of Copenhagen, Malmö, Lund together in the metropolitan competition, which is very tough, which has to do with attracting. I'll come back to that. And then we also thought the decision was taken in 1992 about building the bridge to Sweden in a very pessimistic time, almost as pessimistic as today in economy, but a very pessimistic time in Copenhagen especially, and even more in Malmö, where they had lost all their manufacturing industries. The last one closed, of the large manufacturing industries, closed in 1889, so that was a big shipyard. And then they had a compensation. Scania Vabis was put in for making trucks in Malmö, but that closed down in 1991 with a lot of jobs lost. And that meant that pessimism was there. And the decision of the bridge gave optimism. Not alone, because it was the same year that the Iron Curtain was falling down, and it was the same year that Sweden decided to enter the European market. So it was part of a tree of optimism, and that's important, I think. Large infrastructure creates some kind of optimism. Here's the strategic goal from two systems connected, but not functioning as one, towards something, at least in some parts of economy and social life, which could be called one system. That is the object. And I have drafted some of the circles here a little larger than up here to indicate that 2 + 2 = 5. More growth factors. Synergy has to do with integration, has to do with accessibility, complementarity to things that is on the other side. It has to do with utilization of all the resources in one system. It has to do with economy of scale, simply. New masks also create new specialization. You come up to a higher level in the specialization of the city by the mass. We have seen things, activities entering our system which we never had before, like the large hotel chains of the world, Hilton, Marriott, Sheraton, and so on, came into this Øresund city because of the mere size of the whole city, not because of people crossing Øresund to live in Copenhagen or coming from Malmö and the other way around, but due to the size of the whole urban market. And you also saw distribution centers coming in from the world. For instance, Toyota relocated to Malmö Harbor due to the fact that this new metropolitan unit is the largest metropolitan unit of the northern countries. And you are, when you're in there, you are in two countries, more or less. You are in the largest economy of the Nordic countries, that is Sweden, and you are at the same time in Denmark. So this new mass, the location, cross point, whatever, and then again, optimism, you can use this as a marketing argument. Because the purpose of this BRITS, regional development, not what the round table of industrialists wanted it to be, international transport. Let's see what happened. Well, I've just taken a few figures. Here we have the bridge. This is persons per year moving their life center from one place to another in the Øresund region. That's a lot of people coming from Denmark, the red ones, to South Sweden. We had a little crisis here. And coming from Sweden to Denmark, and that continues. Many of these people moving from Sweden, from Scania to Zealand, are the same that moved the other way, but find out that they missed their mother or whatever. So they wanted to move back. But still, this is a large flow of migrants, and it's driven by differences in prices of housing and goods and so on, taxing. And when you look at the other side of the same thing, another flow, commuters, that's a huge change from almost no, I said 2,000 here, and then up to what we have today, pretty close to 20,000 commuters, almost everybody coming from Sweden going to Denmark. If you count, make a counting of this in GDP, gross product, the value added of in the production of goods and services, then the contribution of Swedish commuters into the Copenhagen system comes close to the value of 6 billion, with a B, billion Danish kroner per year. That's a lot of money. That's the value of a bridge, which has costs something like 30 to 40 billion Danish kroner. Cannot be stated precisely because of the land, infrastructural motorways and railroads also are in the sum. And here we have the traffic. This was a curiosity traffic, very little. And then a steady growth, the peak is tourists. But this is the important thing is here, that's the local traffic, most of that. And the steady growth, and almost still growing, but in the last years it has been slowing down and falling a little. So this is, again, an enormous change from 18, 19, 20 millions to 34 million persons crossing Øresund per month, per year. This is the total per year, and here it's per month. So, concluding about Øresund, cross point enforcement, we are the by far the largest intercontinental flight center in North Europe. You have to go to Frankfurt or Schiphol to find larger. We are the most important crossing point for motorway and railroad traffic, and also, if you also count the Storebelt, for shipping traffic in the Nordic countries. So we are a very important cross point. Also, when you go to the immaterial traffic, we have the largest e-traffic in the Nordic countries in this area. So we have a cross point, we see an enforcement of that, we have seen a lot of companies moving into here, also public bodies like the United Nations was already there but is growing in the area. That has to do with the position as cross point. We are today the by far the largest cruise center of North Europe, with more than 300 ships embarking every year. And that's large ships with a lot of people, a lot of retail buying. Centrality, well, a lot of items are now having their hinterland boundary somewhere midway between Greater Copenhagen, Malmö, Lund, and Greater Stockholm. There's a flow of people coming here. And on the pedestrian street here in the Christmas months, you will hear a lot of people speaking Swedish. In Tivoli, Saturday, it is a Swedish amusement park, more or less, halfway at least. And there's a lot of things like that. The airport here clearly has its daily hinterland, people who drive by car or bus or railroad to the airport is clearly up halfway to Stockholm. Integration is not as fast as we thought it would be, especially when it comes to public businesses like hospitals, universities. Integration is not moving as fast as we thought it would. In the market-oriented parts of the economy, integration is moving. Everybody can see there's a profit, they'll take the profit. So there you have an integration, especially in some specific high-salaried and high-quality parts of business like the pharmaceutical businesses, and also in culture, for instance. New mass, new specialization, yes, that is what I've already talked about it, so I'll not say no more about that. So what we see is actually we're moving towards a new system. And at the same time, what has happened is that we have moved from one balance of growth, things are moving, to another balance. And we are now in that second balance. It took time, it took much more time than it did for Storebælt, and I'll come back to that also. But we are now in a new balance, and that new balance is also characterized by a new growth regime. Not the old growth regime, but a new growth regime. So we have moved from one balance to another balance during this 12 years. Then this one, the Fehmarn Belt, also 20 kilometers here between the island of Lolland, which is connected by bridges to the island of Falster and to Zealand, and with a distance to the German ferry harbors of 18 to 20 kilometers. What do we know about this? It is decided. There is a bilateral treaty. We know almost for sure that it'll be ready 2021. The Øresund Bridge was built to time, actually half a year faster than it was planned to, and to the price. So we think this is realistic. It'll be the by far the largest immersed tunnel in the world. The largest immersed tunnel of the world is actually the tunnel connecting the tunnel connecting the airport of Copenhagen with the little mid-Øresund island from where the bridge is built, 4 kilometers of tunnel. That is because it's an international waterway. You cannot make a bridge without, it has to be very high up in the air because of the Russian fleet. We know the price. We know more or less how many jobs it'll going to create. We also know something about the connecting infrastructure. We are going to build a double railroad where it isn't doubled, just a little minus the Storstrøm, which is the bridge connecting Zealand with Falster and on to the ferry. There we have no decision, but I'm sure it's going to be there. It's much worse in Germany, because what is going to happen is that we in Denmark, due to the international bilateral treaty, we are going to plan, build, we are going to invest, get the capital, we're going to operate the whole investment. And we foresee that maybe local German authorities will not be as cooperative as local Danish authorities. So we already now see that in Germany they are going to create a motorway, but not on the water that separates the island of Fehmarn from the German continent. The same with the train, and they are not going to be ready at the same time as the tunnel will be ready. So it is a more hesitating German level you see there. We also know something about travel time. Copenhagen Hamburg, 33% improvement coming into what is considered okay for a daily meeting. But locally, now you cannot calculate percentages with this huge differences. That's more or less idiotic, but I've done it in here anyway. And from 60 minutes crossing, embarking, to 10 minutes, that's 500% improvement in the local area, and it could be utilized by this area. I'll come back to the problem in a second. This is what it's going to be. Elements be manufactured on Lolland, in the harbor of the ferries now, and it'll be shipped out to a digged trench, and it'll be sunk, and then it'll be connected and so on, and it'll function. And here's the problem formulation around this link. Now if here is the Storebelt, and here is the Øresund link, and now we're building this link, and this is population distribution. And it is clear here you have two large population concentrations and economy concentrations, Copenhagen, Malmö, Lund, and Hamburg. And you have some regional centers here, large regional centers, Kiel, Lübeck, and maybe even Rostock are interacting with this area. And then in between you have more or less a desert. Nobody lives here. I know if you're from North Norway, you wouldn't agree it'll be a densely populated area, but in this part of the world, this is considered almost empty. No cities of size. Copenhagen has shadowed out all urban growth on Zealand, and Hamburg is very dominating in North Germany. So this is more or less the problem formulation. Here it is, the same thing in another way. Metropoles. What is a metropole? It is a center for decision power. It is a place where you concentrate high quality activities of different kind. It is a node in the material and immaterial traffic, and it has to have a size to be defined as a metropole, not in population, but in income, product, interaction with other parts of the world, and in accessibility, and as said, quality. This is, by the way, Hamburg. And if you go out and do science or research on this item, and that has been done by the Bundesinstitut für Bau, Stadt und Raumforschung, and they have published this 10,000 or so metropolitan functions in Europe, the red dots, very clearly concentrated to the center of Europe, but also Paris also. But in the northern part, you have at least 2, 3, 4 concentrations, the Öresund city, Stockholm, Berlin, and Hamburg, and maybe also these two here, Göteborg is there. So you have concentration outside the European centers. And you can go on by this exercise and define yourself and find out that this is metropolitan Europe, more or less. And then you can, that has been done by some of my colleagues at the University of Sorbonne, the Reclus d'Etat group, which is also closely connected with the French National Investment Bureau. And it is considered to be a real definition. They're cooked on data for decades. And they have also delimited the center of Europe. Half of European economic activity in the old European Union is taking place within this blue banana-formed figure. Half of it on the population of something like 25% of Europe is inside this banana. Paris is part of it. And it's on something like 8% of the area. And this banana-formed figure is actually called, in economic terminology, the blue banana. And that is because when it was first introduced at a lecture at Sorbonne 15 years ago or so by a French professor, Claval, who spoke much worse English than I do, and my English is not that good. He was saying all the time when he's presented this, he was saying the boom banana, the boom banana, the boom banana, the gross banana. And then a journalist from International Herald Tribune, he was writing down every time he said boom, he wrote blue. And that came out in his paper and continued to Newsweek and The Economist and Berlingske Tidende and my local newspaper. And it is, this is the terminology, European center. Europe center is called the blue banana. And that's the way the things are done. That has nothing to do with the lecture, but it's interesting. Metropolitan competition. I was presenting this map not to talk about fruits, but to talk about metropolitan competition. And we do compete with the center of Europe about a lot of things. And their specialization pattern and their specialization level is much higher than ours. But our real competitors in Copenhagen is Stockholm, Hamburg, Berlin, and Warsaw coming up. Not so much Oslo and Helsinki, but these four cities are real competitors. And what do we compete about? We compete about activity, guests, family and business guests, conferences, events, whatever. We compete about investments from the world. We compete about qualified labor. And we try to compete also when it comes to the framework for doing business. But actually, the framework for doing business in North Europe is not that different. So every time some part of this area changes the framework, the other ones does the same. We have something in South Scandinavia which we can build grand strategies on. I already talked about the Öresund region, but also the Hamburg-Öresund corridor, a new powerhouse of growth. Here we have the competitors. Copenhagen alone, together with the South Swedish centers, economic strengths, that's gross product, regional gross product, large centers. Copenhagen comes a little up when it unites with Öresund in this calculation. By far the largest international air traffic. And very interesting when you look at this, the creativity level. Actually, Berlin is the strongest of these cities. Stockholm comes close, but is overrun by or overtaken by the Öresund city when you count like this. That Hamburg, which by the way is the richest city in North Europe, in Europe more or less, is a dwarf when it comes to research. This is papers in Science Citation Index over a three-year period distributed on the address of the author. And this is also the competitive level of this city illustrated with this. I'm also showing you one more item which I think is interesting when it comes to the Fehmarn Belt connection. This is the plans for high-speed railroads, which is actually also now on the International Union of Railroads home sites. That map shows where you have realistic plans or already high-speed trains. And it's the system that's interesting. And it's very clear that this is a white part of the map. It is like the Ituri wood of Congo was when I was joining school, going to school. A little scandal, I think it is, that we do not have any plans for high-speed railroads, because they could, or if they came here, they could establish a North European center in the airport of Kastrup, helping Kastrup to compete, and also being a very interesting thing for the whole city of Copenhagen with a Scandinavian network and a European network connected here. We've also done a little survey, and I hope I have time to go through it. 5 minutes it'll take me, and then I have 5 minutes more. We have asked a lot of people in the Fehmarn Belt area about everything. And we have asked young people, because there you can get something you can get nowhere else in sociology. You can get 100% response, because you ask their teacher in high school or in other youth schools types, and they say, yes, we will happily use 1 hour to go through your questions. then we don't have to do anything. You can just sit down, the teacher. So they all say yes. And then we send in a student and they ask all these questions and get all the answers. And we have a complete coverage. And people who are around 19 years, they are also very good to ask questions about the future because they're thinking a lot about the future. They're going to leave school and do something else. They're going to start their life as grown-ups. So they're very good to ask those kind of people. And we have, as I said, asked them about a lot of things. Found out that there are no differences between the youth in South Sweden, East Denmark, and North Germany when it comes to a lot of things. They are the same type of post-materialistic, value-bearing persons. They have the same attitudes towards a lot of things. The dividing line is not between countries, it's between the sexes. There are larger differences between men and women than between Denmark, Sweden, and Germany. There is some differences, and we have listed one here. That is the environment. The Swedish youth think that the market will solve the problems. The German youth prefer regulations. And the Danish youth thinks that this issue is characterized by unnecessary alarms. But here is an interesting thing. There's a very big lack of information about the other countries. Especially it is so that Danish and Swedish youngsters know nothing about Hamburg. They know much more about Kreuzberg and Prenzlauer Straße in Berlin than they know about the whole city of Hamburg. They think Hamburg is an industrial center with communistic laborers and smoke, brown stacks, and there's a zoological garden there, and there's a very bad football team, but they know nothing about Hamburg. And the same for Hamburg youth about Copenhagen. There's a real demand for commercializing, for marketing, for education about the other side. If you ask these young people, do you want to work, live, study in Denmark? Everybody loves Denmark. Yes, 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 yes. Danish youth, do you want to work only if there's money on the table? We'll go to Germany. You're not going to live there and not going to study there. And the Swedish youth, same. And Danish youth, they seem to be very happy to be where they are. Where the German youth, they really want to go away. Strange. This is a model of this regional setup today. This is the Fehmarn Belt, this is Greater Copenhagen, Malmö Lund, the periphery, Hamburg, and there's also the periphery of North Germany here. There is interaction, but a lot of the interaction between the centers are directly. There's very little interaction crossing the Fehmarn Belt, and in the peripheral areas you have unbalanced, incomplete systems of the economy and of social life and so on, or mostly of the economy. And then what we think could be established, first of all, getting closer between the metropolitan units, they can have a higher interaction level. A lot of that will go directly between Hamburg and the South Scandinavian Center. But it could be so that you could establish a real border region in the peripheral areas and connect with some activity systems, even try to establish common systems. And you could also try to steal or get some of the interaction between the large cities into your system by demanding, like the naval station of Copenhagen was moved to Storebælt, then you could demand to have some modern activities from the Danish government moved into the peripheral areas, like a university institute or a Danish-German cultural institute or something like that. What do we think? We think the large centers will have the largest chains, and this is the large centers. They'll have cross-point enforcement. If the European high-speed railroad system is established, that'll be a very interesting thing, as said. They will move up in the international metropolitan competition by showing off that they could complement each other's, and they can make metropolitan cooperation on clusters and research and culture. The neighboring regions, well, we know that they'll lose employment, they'll have a shock. But in the construction period, they will have employment. In the construction period, they'll see an increase in interaction and cooperation. They could establish themselves as a real border region. They could put demands on activities from the national level or the lender level in Germany. We're sure that a new infrastructure will create higher real estates. We're sure that if you have the real estate, if you have the high-speed trains in, we'll see a dramatic increase in real estate at the stations. And there could be one station in South Denmark, and that'll be a hotspot. And then, of course, there'll be some new localization patterns, especially around tourism in the corridor itself. This is a strategic goal, a new North European powerhouse. This is, again, Hamburg, Kiel, Lübeck, Rostock, Copenhagen, Malmö, Lund, based on new infrastructure and new internal networks in research and in business. And then we come to the final part of what I'm going to say, namely, now we're here. Distance, not at all, but almost here. Distance is now kilometers. We have completed one of the world's largest, mega largest infrastructural products ever. These three huge links and all the corridors that has been developed to make them function is one of the largest mega projects in the world, coming up to a price of much more than 100 billion Danish kroner themselves. And we can see the consequences of them by trying to count traffic once more. That's just an example. Here we have counted all traffic between Zealand and the rest of the area here. Ferries here and ferries here and ferries here and ferries here and the bridge and the tunnel here, they're all calculated as one figure, and the same for the two others. And that gives these curves. The first one, this great build, the dramatic jump in traffic, and then the new growth regime. Öresund, here we have the link, not as dramatic because you had to learn a lot. That was a learning project. You didn't have all these networks established already, as we had inside Denmark. You have to learn to establish network, you have to establish them, and you have to use them, materialize them. So it took much more time to get traffic up. And it is still growing. What we see here is more of a new growth regime than it is a new level. But it is also a new level. And then we don't know, of course, what will happen here. We think that a doubling of traffic would be a pretty good guess, maybe a tripling of traffic. Thank you.